With his test runs now complete, Rick was finally ready to enter service on the Dark Railway. Sporting a new coat of green paint, he was brought outside the works after being steamed up. Mr. Smash came to see him.
Guess we'd better hear that whistle of yours before you leave, eh?
Yes, please, sir. I'd love to know what it sounds like.
Very well. Pull the cord! What was that?
Is an ocean liner docking nearby? Wow! That was loud!
What?
I said that was loud!
Pardon?
I said...
Speak up! I can't hear ya!
Oh no! I've broken Mr. Smash!
Ha 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 ha! I'm only teasing you, Rick. But yes, that is very loud indeed. Sounds great though. Matches your impressive stature, don't you think?
If you say so, sir.
Now then, you're discharged from my care from the time being. You're off to Kolhapa, so that you may pull your inaugural passenger train tomorrow, on which I shall be travelling to see how well you do with coaches.
Coaches?
Yes, indeed. You'll enjoy it, I'm sure.
I hope so.
Now remember, if you have any mechanical problems, or feel strange in any way or form, do let someone know, and we'll bring you right back to the works to check you over, alright?
Understood, Mr. Smash.
Excellent. Off you go then, and the best of luck to you, Rick.
Thank you, sir. And with that, Rick departed from the works for what he hoped would be the last time for a while. When he arrived at Kolhapa Sheds, Rick was pleasantly surprised to find that Dave was there, along with another similar looking engine.
Rick, is that you?
I could barely recognise you without your boring grey paintwork. Mr. Smash repainted me into green. Now I almost look like you.
Not quite, I'm more attractive. But yeah, you're just missing the lining really.
Mr. Smash says that I'm to remain like this for a while because this is how Bob would have looked when he first arrived on the line.
Makes sense, I guess. For anybody who remembers him anyway.
Mr. Smash would. He's ancient.
And Mr. Dark.
The only thing bothering me though is that puny little tender.
I agree. Doesn't look right attached to such a large engine. I'm Stan, by the way. Dave's told me all about you now, Rick.
Stan? Are you Dave's brother?
Well, kind of. We're as close to brothers as you can realistically get, because I was built in a different time and place to Dave. But we're the same design, and we've almost always referred to ourselves as brothers.
It's a bit complicated, Rick, but for all intents and purposes, yes, Stan is my brother. Dave's spoken about you a lot. He thinks quite highly of you, Stan. And if Dave thinks highly of you, then so do I. Stan blushed.
Well, gosh. Thank you, Rick. Funnily enough, Dave's spoken very highly of you too.
Of course I have! Look at him! He's the most impressive looking engine I've ever seen! Rick also appeared to blush slightly, as Stan continued.
So, you've been released to traffic then, Rick?
So I've been told. Mr. Smash says I'm to pull a passenger train tomorrow, with lots of important people coming to travel behind me. I've only pulled trucks so far on my test runs, you see. Is there much of a difference between pulling passengers and trucks? Dave and Stan glanced at each other.
Well, not really. Most engines prefer pulling coaches to trucks because it's deemed more of a social status thing to be allowed to pull coaches. Personally, I don't really mind either.
I prefer coaches. They're usually smoother and easier to handle. But some engines, like our mate Barry, will do almost anything to avoid taking passengers. He's a freight engine, just like you. So, I'm a freight engine.
I'd say you're more of a mixed traffic engine, like us. You'll probably find that you'll be asked to pull anything and everything.
Suits me. I can't wait to get to work properly.
You could learn a thing or two from this guy, Dave. You hate working.
I don't. I worked hard earlier this year, didn't I?
Only because you were after something from Zeke.
Yeah, but I don't mind working. Sometimes. The three engines continued to speak for a while, until it was time for Stan to take a service up the line. Colossus, who had brought Stan's train in, shuffled over to the sheds to meet the new engine. All right, Colossus.
Very well, thank you, Dave. This must be 1202.
His name's Rick.
A pleasure to make your acquaintance, Rick. My name is Colossus.
Colossus? I've heard of you. Dave's mentioned you before, when we were trying to come up with a name for him.
Well, Colossus would have been a very fitting name for you, young engine. You are certainly one of the biggest engines I have ever seen.
I presume that's a good thing?
Oh, of course, no offence meant at all.
Bet it's a relief to finally see him completed and working then, Colossus.
Indeed it is. I remember hearing about your construction. All kept very secret, of course. But myself and a few other engines discovered what was going on regardless. I must say, I am rather surprised.
Surprised?
Surprised that Zeke and Mr. Smash managed to build you in the first place. It must have been a Herculean task, building all of your components and such, especially considering that your design is completely unique. But they clearly know what they're doing, because you're here. How are you finding things so far then?
Everything is so fascinating. The works, the museum, the railway at night, trucks, sheds, other engines. It is slightly overwhelming, but I'm getting used to things.
Well, Rick, if you ever need any help or advice, you can ask me.
Colossus has been around the block a few times. He's a good source of advice if you need it, Rick.
Thank you.
I'll remember that. As the hours passed, Dave and Rick continued to chat with Colossus, soon to be replaced with Eddie, then, finally, Stan again, who stayed for a short while before departing with an evening train, leaving Dave and Rick alone to get a good night's sleep. Rick awoke with a slight start the following morning, for an unfamiliar engine was stood right in front of him.
Gah! Whoa! It's real!
Morning, Alan. Where have you been at?
Me? I was helping out at Somi yesterday, so didn't come down here or anything. This is the new engine, then?
Yep. His name is Rick.
Rick? Bit of a letdown. I was hoping that you'd be called Olympic, Captain Chonker, or Absolute Unit. You know, something to reflect your size, because size matters, of course. That's what my driver used to say. And,
Alan, back away from him a bit, will you? Give him some space. Alan obliged, reversing away slightly as he continued to gawk at Rick.
But yeah, I told you, Dave. I knew it. I knew he was building a new steam engine.
Yes, yes, Alan, you were right.
So, what has he done so far? Has he been up and down the line? Has he set a new haulage record for Upway Bank? And has he broken any of our bridges yet?
Alan, don't be rude.
Sorry, it's all just very exciting, isn't it? Brand new engine, brand new adventure for him. All change for us lot. We're old hat compared to Rick.
Alan?
Dave?
Don't you have some coaches to attend to?
Oh, right, yeah. I guess you're taking the special train this morning then.
Apparently I am.
Nice one. Can't wait to see you stomping up and down the line. I'll go get them sorted for you right now.
And with that, Alan bustled away. Rick seemed rather confused.
Who was that?
Alan. He's alright. Just a bit excitable sometimes.
And he's a shunting engine, like Mr. B?
Yeah. He's a hard worker, really. But he can be a bit crude and blunt sometimes.
I think I see that.
Whilst Alan collected the coaches from the siding, a familiar face had come to greet Dave and Rick.
Well, Rick, today's the day. We're finally going to be putting you into full service with the other engines. How are you feeling?
Slightly nervous again, but as long as my coupling holds.
I'm certain that you won't have another incident with your tender coupling hook now, Rick.
Too powerful for your own good, eh?
Rick looked slightly embarrassed as Zeke continued.
So, this morning, we're going to be taking you on a special train up the line with lots of very important guests. Now, don't be nervous. Just pull the train like you did with the trucks.
Okay, sir.
And we're going to be attaching a headboard to you this morning, too.
A headboard?
Yeah. It's just a big metal plate that sits atop your top lamp iron on your front.
Oh, right. Anyway, I just wanted to quickly check up on you and make sure you're all right. I've just got to go and welcome everybody to the train, so I'll see you in a few minutes, Rick.
Zeke hurried away, and Dave grinned.
Bless him, he's so excited.
I wish I could be excited. I'm just nervous again.
Don't be, you'll be fine.
And what if I make a mistake again?
I'm sure that you won't. Now, go and pull that train. I'm sure you'll enjoy your first experience with coaches.
Maybe. Oh, looks like I'm going. I'll see you later, Dave.
Good luck, Rick.
Shortly, Rick was at the head of a long rake of coaches, blowing off steam nervously. Zeke had approached him and affixed a headboard to his top lamp iron, smiling at Rick as he did so. As people crowded around him, Rick got a little bit flustered, not being particularly fond of all this attention that he had been receiving. Most of all, he didn't want to make any mistakes or cause any mishaps on this journey, especially as Zeke and other important people were travelling in the train this morning. He didn't have too much time to contemplate this though, for he heard the guard's whistle from behind him, and his driver blew his whistle, which, Rick worried, would almost certainly deafen somebody if they stood too close to him. Regardless, his pistons began to move, and he slowly, but surely, departed from Kolhapur, for his first run with coaches up the entire dark railway. Alan watched his departure with interest.
Quite amazing to see him pulling a train. Such a big engine. Such a powerhouse. So heavy. Just like Gordon. Hang on a minute. Gordon, he was a big engine. Like Rick. Heavy axle load. And the bridges. That can't have been a coincidence. Dave! I worked out a thing! I'm a fucking genius!
As he travelled along the line, Rick looked around at the scenery as he passed by, having not seen it properly during his mostly nighttime runs so far. He began to make mental notes of various places along the line, such as the small junction just past Axley, where he hadn't been yet, the impressive Woolchurch Viaduct, and of course, the steep incline between Upway and Manston 4 stations. This part he enjoyed greatly, purposely slowing down a little bit, so he could hear the rhythm of his exhaust as he strolled up the hill, almost effortlessly. Presently, he arrived at the end of the line at Mearcombe, where, again, large crowds of people were waiting to see him as he entered the platform. Zeke, Mr. Smash, Mr. Dark, and another man that he didn't recognise approached him. The unknown man, who was actually Mr. Chairman, spoke first.
Well, Zeke Caracas, I have to say, I wasn't sure you'd be able to pull this off, but you pulled this off. What an incredible machine you've built here.
He is a very fine locomotive indeed, Mr. Chairman, and already I'm very proud of him. Whilst the two men continued to talk, Zeke addressed Rick. So then, how did you find taking coaches, Rick? It didn't feel much different to taking trucks. Not as heavy for one thing, but they do ride very smoothly along the rails behind me. I'm sure I can get used to them. I'm sure that you will. Now that that's done, we're going to be rostering you onto regular passenger trains for the rest of the day, so that the general public can experience travel behind you, alright? Alright, sir. Zeke turned back to the men, and Mr. Smash spoke.
Everything's stuffed, gentlemen. I think Rick is good to go. Now then, how about a pub lunch? My treat?
Caracas, it's not even midday yet.
And I'm paying.
For the rest of that day, Rick busied himself taking passenger trains up and down the line. Though he enjoyed pulling coaches, he didn't particularly enjoy having to stop at every station, especially when hundreds of people seemed to be waiting to swarm him whenever he stopped. On the whole though, his first day in service went without a hitch, until he retired for the evening at Mearcombe Sheds. As Rick rolled into one of the vacant shed roads, he saw a few familiar engines, such as Colossus and Eddie, waiting for him. With them were a couple of less familiar engines, some that he had seen on his travels along the line during the day, and others whom he did not recognise at all. One of the smaller engines shouted as he backed in.
Oh my God, Sid! Look! It's Big Boobs! Back from the grave to ride the rails once again! Big Bob, you numpty!
Big Bob, then! Actually, my name is Rick. I'm a replica,
we know.
We're only pulling your wheels, mate. Welcome.
I assume your first day in service was a success, then?
I think so. I'm not sure I like all of the crowds of humans, though.
They're just excited to see the country's newest steam locomotive, and an impressive one at that.
Somebody scoffed rather audibly at this. Eddie spoke again.
It'll die down eventually, Rick.
Indeed. It's just that initial excitement.
I just don't want a big fuss made of me.
Completely understandable.
If you want us to treat you like any other engine, Rick, we will.
Yeah, we can tease and bully you if you want. That'll make you feel right at home.
Perhaps not, Ed.
But overall, yeah. I've enjoyed my first day in service. I'm meeting lots of new engines, seeing how lovely the railway is. But most of all, I'm kind of glad to be away from Mr. Smash's works now.
Too bad it wasn't sooner, really.
Rick looked over at the large blue diesel that had spoken. Clearly, Warrior hadn't realised that he had spoken so clearly, as he looked a little taken aback when Rick spoke innocently.
What do you mean? Was my help needed then?
Don't worry about it, Rick. It's not important.
Well, it is important, actually. Oh! Finish scoffing, have you?
I don't know what you mean, Edward. You'd be wise to avoid calling me that, carrot cake. All I was going to say is that it is important that you have been completed now, Rick. That means that we can all have some proper maintenance again. I am in need of repairs myself, actually. So I am glad that the works has been reopened. It's just a shame that Mr. Smash neglected to tell me anything about your construction.
Oh, here we go again. Eddie, please.
No, Colossus. He's been whinging and whining about not being told about Rick's construction ever since he found out about him. Mr. Smash kept it a secret for a reason, which is why we didn't say anything about it. And
wait, what?
What do you mean?
Nothing.
You knew? You knew about DR-1202 before me?
So what if I did?
And you, Colossus?
Yes. Yes, I know about him.
Did anybody else know?
Dave knew. He said another diesel did too. Turbo, I think he said his name was. And
now isn't the time, Rick.
Caracas looked livid. So, the truth comes out. You lot all knew about Mr. Smash's little pet before anybody else.
Pet? How dare you call Rick a pet? He's literally right there, Caracas. Don't be so fucking rude.
He's not wrong though, is he? All this time, Mr. Smash was keeping him a secret. But you guys knew. And you know the real reason why the works was closed. Why didn't you tell us?
There's no need to bring this up, Warrior. Please, Rick is right here. Let's not upset him on his first day. Oh, so you care about his feelings, but not ours? What about my superheaters? And what about Warrior's engines? And how about Andy? Remember him? Oh, get over yourself, you pedantic prick. You don't really care about any of that. All you care about is the fact that Mr. Smash didn't tell you about Rick first. And now, you're bitter about it. All because your precious owner didn't immediately make a beeline for you to tell you his big juicy secret.
You back off him, Eddie.
Get bent, Warrior. You're no better. I heard what you said about Rick the other day.
I only meant...
I don't care what you meant by it. It was disgusting. Rick hadn't even been out on test yet, and you were already bad-mouthing him for, allegedly, taking up the entire works when everybody could have been having repairs and restorations. And then, you had the sheer audacity to bring up Andy again. Do you really think that any of that is Rick's fault at all? If either of you have such a problem with it, take it up with Mr. Smash, but don't you dare take it out on Rick.
Warrior looked as if he were readying a reply, but Colossus cut in.
That's enough, all of you. Eddie, I'm ashamed of you. There's no need to escalate the situation as you've just done. I know, but Eddie is right though. None of this is Rick's fault, and bringing it all up again is not going to help anybody.
He looked towards Rick, who had remained almost completely silent for all of this.
Don't you worry about it, Rick. Emotions are running a little bit high at the moment. Everybody requires attention from Mr. Smash and his team, and it is, indeed, a shame that he and Zeke chose to keep your construction a secret. But that does not detract from the fact that you're an innocent party here. And nobody, and I mean nobody, can lay any blame on you for what the humans decide to do, secrets or otherwise.
Rick looked up towards Caracas and Warrior. I understand that this whole thing with the works being closed isn't exactly my fault, but to both of you, Caracas, Warrior, I'm sorry that my construction caused problems for the both of you. I don't want to feel like I'm an inconvenience for anybody. I just hope that I can make it up to you both someday. I want to make friends, not enemies.
Both engines looked rather taken aback at this. Rick, I didn't mean to appoint blame to you. I'm more just frustrated with Mr. Smash, the man I look up to, the man who saved me from being scrapped, kept such an important thing from me. I know it isn't actually your fault. And Colossus and Eddie are right. I'm sorry for flying off the handle.
Eddie scoffed loudly at this, but didn't say anything else. Rick now addressed Warrior.
Goose told me about Andy?
Yes. He was a good friend of mine. And I miss him very much.
I'm sorry to hear that he decided to leave the railway. But the engines in the museum told me that he wanted to donate parts so that he could save his brother.
That's right.
That's a very noble and difficult decision for him to have made. Perhaps, if I'd not been built, he could have stayed?
No, not exactly. Mr. Smash wouldn't have been able to repair him. The damage was too great. I see that now. I'm sorry, Rick, for being so judgmental and negative against you.
It's okay. I would feel the same way in your situation. I don't blame you. I just hope that someday you won't resent me for having been built.
Warrior looked horrified at these words.
I don't resent you, Rick. I've finally just been clouded by guilt and sorrow for the loss of my friend, and I'll be rational about it. especially once my engine's failed on me.
It's okay, Warrior. I think I understand. Warrior gave a small smile as Ed chimed in.
Right! Now that we've all finished arguing and being soppy, anybody want to hear the story of how me and Sid once blackmailed an engine into stealing coal for us?
Ed began his story, unprovoked, and Colossus whispered to Rick.
You handled that very well, Rick. Very mature, I must admit.
Thank you. I do understand where they're coming from, though. But I also know that it isn't me, personally, that has upset them.
I quite agree.
I do hope that they won't be mad at Mr. Smash, though.
You know very well that Mr. Smash will have none of it. Come on now, Rick. Let's relax a little and hear what Ed has to say. Something ridiculous, I'd imagine, though.
Rick tried to settle down to listen to the stories, but a nagging feeling had developed within him. Had his construction really upset so many engines? And would he meet more hostility from others in the future? He sincerely hoped not. Next time, he might not be able to successfully defuse the situation or have an engine like Colossus on hand to help. Eventually, though, he lost track of what was being said in the sheds and succumbed to tiredness once again.